said, the outcome of this theme will feed into the shared outcome of the, all the other themes. There are five themes, as you know, and the shared outcomes of this, the five themes is realizing clear commitments for implementing mechanisms to deliver impacts, okay, through collective action, to improve the effectiveness of research and innovation systems, and to build on these research and innovation systems. And all this outcome, again, will be part of the final, as I stated, outcome statement of GCAR 3, where participants will pledge to work together on a list of collective action, and hopefully, whatever we reach here will be part of this list. In reaching to these outcomes, we will develop and commit to collective action guided by the SDGs of the United Nations and by few lenses. So the SDGs that we have identified, you know that there are like sustainable development goals of the that have been announced are 17. We have identified for this theme the SDG 1, 3, 4, 5, 8, 9, and 11, and they are about no poverty, good health, quality education, gender equality, decent employment and economic growth, industry, innovation, infrastructure, and sustainable cities and communities. I'm not saying that we have to cover all of that, but this is how we are linking our theme 5, which is about better rural futures, to the SDGs and to the outcomes of this meeting, as a matter of fact. We will do that also using identified lenses, which are inclusion. So this is also what we need during our discussion to be considering. Inclusion, capacity development, foresight, of course, partnership with focus on youth farmers, farmer rights, the farm-based enterprises, and the concept of no one left behind. And how we will do that, we have six sessions. Okay, so this is the first session. We'll have the panelists. So session 1 and 2 will be here in this panel room, in this big room, and we'll have the presentations or like the interventions of our catalysts who are with us here. And then after lunch, we will come back here to have the discussions and the agreement on the collective action. Then we will move to room Barcelona, and we will have our focus groups or roundtables there, where we will pick the catalyst that you want to sit with, as a matter of fact, on the table. So every catalyst that will talk in this panel session will be sitting on a table with their idea of their collective action that they are working on. And if you are interested, you join them and you build together maybe a bigger, a stronger collective action by bringing your ideas to theirs. And this is what we will announce at the end. So we will work on that in session 3 and 4, which are today, this afternoon. We will be left then by session 5 and 6 of the parallel sessions. And this will be on Friday morning. So we will start on Friday morning by what we call a world cafe, where actually the different roundtables will have their posters posted. So at the end of this day today, you will have a poster with your collective action. We will work further on the poster together, maybe tomorrow or this afternoon, we will decide on a time. And then you will have an exhibition of your posters, and everyone will be able to go around and discuss it with you. And you know, you strengthen it further through gathering more ideas and have a better poster after that. The last session, which is also on Friday, is session 6, and this is when we will actually come up together on agreements of what we are taking to the bigger conference through a collective action that we are gonna announce that you all want to work on in the coming 3 years, and with better posters and all of that. And then we will take this to the organization of the meeting, and they will include them in the final statement as the work that has come out of this theme. So this is exactly what we are doing. Before we proceed with our panelists, we have a few definitions to give to you. I will define what we mean by collective action, because we need to be in agreement on that, because that's what we are doing. And my colleague, Robin Bourgeois, will define what is foresight, because we are using foresight to reach collective action. So the GFAR definition of collective action is, and I'm sure that you have heard it before, just to get us all on the same place, it's a multi-stakeholder program of work that can happen at national, regional, or international level, and initiated by 3 or more partners. So if 3 people are around the table and they are agreeing on collective action, we can go with this collective action. Okay, so three or more partners, always including farmers or farmer representative in the conference, with particular focus on women and youth, okay, and the lenses that we have just mentioned, resulting in partners in collective action agreeing to commit and generate and use resources together to transform research and innovation systems or situations on the ground. Collective action should result in added value through joint action. That's why you are in collective action, so it should be added value, and collective action should be equitable, effective, and demand-driven. The results of your collective action, just as an example, could be a project, but also not necessarily a project. You can have a chat group. You can agree in collective action to develop a chat group, a website, a learning and communication initiative, a research project, an application of something that is out there, an initiative to, for example, to give access to finance based on the presentation that we have just had, when they mentioned that access to finance or to market is a problem for the youth. So this can be an initiative. So an initiative, research, project, web page, website, chat, media, all of this is collective action as long as there are three organizations who are willing to participate in it. With this, I will stop. I will call to my colleague, Robin Bourgeois, for presenting. And for our catalyst, I just want to mention something. I have here a bag of turmeric and a bag of chili that I got actually from outside. You can get them. I will use the turmeric bag to tell our catalyst that they have 1 minute to go. I will use the chili hot bag to say, that's, you need to stop now, okay? So look for the turmeric and chili. Every catalyst has 6 to 7 minutes, as a matter of fact, to present, because we want to finish and start our discussions. Thank you very much.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. For me, it's still morning. We have not lunch too yet. Okay, I would like to share with you a few words about what we call generically forward thinking, of which foresight is part. Is there a way for the next slide to... I do not have any device to change the slides, you know, how... Okay. When we are talking about forward thinking, we are talking about two possibilities. You can be what we call be pre-active. It means that you consider that the events in the future, longer term events, are already set to happen, and the only thing that you can do about it would be to prepare yourself for that. That means that you are looking somehow at long trends, and you are considering that these trends will never change, and what happens in the future, well, it will happen anyway, and you just have to be prepared for that. Example, in the Philippines, we know that typhoons recurrently hit the Philippines, so you have to build shelters to make sure that when the typhoons are hitting the Philippines, you are protected. This is the preactive. You know that it will happen, and you have to do something about it so that it will not hurt you. This is important. But in forward thinking, there is something which we consider is even more important, which is being proactive, which means that to some extent, you consider that changes are possible, disruptions, breaks, and you can do something about the future. So if I take the example of the Philippines again and the typhoons, I would say, could I imagine a way to make sure that the typhoons won't hit the Philippines again? Can I devise something that will break the typhoon before it gets to my coasts? And in that case, you will have been proactive because you will have changed the future. So foresight is basically about being proactive. So sometimes people say, well, yes, but why should we do that? Because we don't know what might happen and it's so difficult, etc. So is it really needed to do it? And the answer in this small drawing here, I have taken that from a French humorist, which says it is better to pump even if nothing happens rather than risking something worse happening if we did not pump. So change pump with doing foresight, and you know exactly why we are here. It's better to do foresight even if nothing happens rather than something worse happening because we have not done foresight. Next slide, please. Okay, so foresight, what does it mean? Very simple. It means we use the future to change the present, to change the future. If you remember that, those are simple words, but they are very, very strong words. We use the future to change the present, to change the future. So it's not anymore about prediction. It's about being proactive, as I said, and it's about being a change agent. Let's see what it means in the next slide. So how we can do it? It's not about technology, it's not about tools and methods only. Usually a lot of people will tell you that using the future requires particular skills and that's it. No, it's more than that. It's a change in the mindset. Using the future is exactly what my young colleague and friend Jim Kano said this morning, quoting Gandhi, it's being the future you want to see happening in the world. That's, it is becoming an agent of change. It is becoming future smart in your mind. But of course, in order to do that, you need to use some kind of tools and methods. And this is why I presented this sculpture of what we call in French a passe muraille, someone who has the skills and the aptitude to cross a wall without needing a door. So foresight is also something about that. Now, last slide. Who can do it? Well, Madame la Présidente, you can do it. I probably can do it. They can do it. We can all do it. Actually, everybody can do it. And it is even better when we can do it together, because in forward thinking, and especially in foresight, when you want to be proactive, there are no beneficiaries. We are all beneficiaries, or better speaking, we are all actors. We are all doers. Thank you very much.
Welcome on stage, Elizabeth Atangana.
Merci beaucoup, je m'appelle Elizabeth Atangana. Merci de me passer la parole. À la suite de ces mots de Robin, je m'en vais tout simplement vous présenter également quelques mots en ce qui concerne la place et le rôle des organisations de producteurs dans cette imagination du futur, peut-être d'un meilleur futur. Et nous l'avons intitulé « Les organisations paysannes et producteurs, communautés locales d'abord ». D'abord, pourquoi? Il faut que ces organisations développent leur autonomisation par rapport à la prospective. Alors, ce à quoi nous voulons arriver, d'abord, des organisations de producteurs et des communautés locales qui utilisent la prospective pour déterminer et négocier les futurs qu'elles souhaitent. En fait, les organisations de producteurs, ce sont des acteurs de terrain et ces organisations font face à un certain nombre de défis. Ces défis souvent nécessitent des solutions qui parfois sont plutôt recherchées par d'autres personnes que ces organisations elles-mêmes. Aujourd'hui, nous pensons que les organisations doivent être proactives et être au centre même de la prospective. Et pourquoi ? Cela, il faudrait qu'elle soit en mesure de transformer de façon proactive le système de recherche et d'innovation agricole pour qu'il contribue à la transformation des futurs souhaités. Parfois, elles sont acculées par la pression urbaine. Il ne faut pas que cette pression les surprenne, par exemple. Il faut qu'elles se préparent, n'est-ce pas, à pouvoir réagir pour qu'elles puissent mieux s'imposer dans leur territoire. Elles veulent également utiliser la prospective pour soutenir les positions, pour faire prendre en compte les aspirations des populations. En fait, les décideurs, souvent, veulent qu'on leur donne une preuve pourquoi on doit investir, par exemple, dans l'agriculture. Donc, la prospective menée de manière autonome par les organisations paysannes devrait être à même de pouvoir convaincre les décideurs à pouvoir investir, par exemple, dans la recherche, investir dans la production, investir dans l'agriculture familiale pour la transformer et la rendre un business pour les communautés rurales, par exemple. Maintenant, par rapport à ce qui a été présenté tout à l'heure, comment est-ce que nous, organisations paysannes, nous sommes-nous engagés dans cette expérience? Alors, pour s'engager, il a d'abord fallu que nous prenions le leadership dans la mise en œuvre, d'abord par la capacitation, c'est-à-dire le développement de nos compétences internes, endogènes, donc former des facilitateurs internes dans l'organisation, et après, organiser un dialogue au niveau du territoire pour que l'ensemble des parties prenantes, que ce soit les pouvoirs publics, les femmes, les jeunes, les religieux, les chefs traditionnels, puissent comprendre notre objectif et qu'ils puissent s'approprier cet objectif et participent à l'initiative de prospective locale. Il a fallu également, à la suite de cela, atteindre un certain nombre de résultats et ensemble mettre en œuvre un plan d'action. Alors, qu'est-ce qui a été fait avec qui nous avons pu mener cette expérience? Nous avons mené l'expérience avec au niveau du Pakistan, les Philippines, avec le South Palan Island. Nous avons travaillé en Indonésie avec la communauté Boru, avec AFA, qui est une organisation de l'Asie. Et nous avons travaillé au niveau du Cameroun avec la Concertation nationale des organisations paysannes, au Congo-Brazzaville et au Gabon. Et qui était facilitateur? C'était des organisations régionales, AFA et PROPAC. Et nous avons bénéficié évidemment d'un appui technique du GEFAR, en la personne de Robin, qui a été ici tout à l'heure, qui est passé dans chacun de nos pays pour essayer de nous accompagner, à nous approprier cette expérience qui n'était que l'expérience des techniciens, des experts, mais qui aujourd'hui construit des experts endogènes, des experts fermiers. Et à la suite de cela, qu'avons-nous pu réaliser? Nous avons pu, à la suite de cette formation en prospective locale, développer des personnes ressources au sein des organisations paysannes au niveau de AFA et au niveau de la PROPAC pour permettre la facilitation et la mise en œuvre de la prospective. Nous avons également développé des experts nationaux au niveau de chacun des pays qui ont été identifiés, au niveau de la PROPAC également, qui est la plateforme régionale des organisations paysannes, et au niveau de AFA, qui est l'organisation fédérative des producteurs en Asie. Alors, qu'est-ce que nous avons retiré de cette réflexion et de cette démarche? D'abord, au niveau de AFA, un espoir de motivation des communautés locales pour une agriculture durable et résiliente. De cette perspective, il en ressort également la possibilité que les communautés locales travaillent avec les autorités. Ils ont pu mobiliser les autorités, toutes les parties prenantes, comme je l'ai dit tantôt, pour la promotion des cultures locales, la diversification des sources de revenus basées sur les entreprises locales. Et au niveau de la PROPAC, ce que nous avons pu engendrer, c'est d'abord une grande prise de conscience des populations qu'elles ne devraient plus attendre que tout leur arrive, mais qu'elles devraient se préparer et à se projeter dans l'avenir pour préparer le futur de leur territoire. Et nous avons également développé la capacité des populations à analyser leur environnement, à penser des solutions par elles-mêmes et pour leur permettre de se projeter dans l'avenir. Il y en a qui ont choisi 10 ans, il y en a qui se sont projetés sur 20 ans, ce qui était vraiment incroyable au début, que les populations pensent leur avenir sur 10, 20 ans. et qu'elle pense également des enjeux tels que la pression urbaine sur le foncier agricole, par exemple. C'est quelque chose que nous avons pu réaliser avec les communautés. Et l'identification, par exemple, de comment transformer leur environnement par l'éducation pour transformer les mentalités, pour qu'ils prennent en main leur développement. Et évidemment, l'intérêt du dialogue participatif. Comment faire en sorte que les pouvoirs publics, qui sont souvent éloignés, soient de manière horizontale assis autour d'une table pour discuter avec les communautés et qu'ils prennent en compte les besoins de ces communautés. On va voir quelques photos. Là, nous avons AFA qui est en train de réaliser avec le groupe, n'est-ce pas, à travers de ce diagramme. Et il y a le groupe de femmes qu'on est en train de montrer de manière spécifique pour faire prendre en compte les aspirations et des groupes minoritaires tels que les femmes, les jeunes et les populations vulnérables. Alors, avec quels partenaires voulons-nous poursuivre cette grande expérience pour nous qui est quelque chose de fondamental? D'abord, les organisations paysannes elles-mêmes et la société civile et les gouvernements et les collectivités locales décentralisées. Si nous voulons rendre durable, pérenne l'initiative prospective, il faut des ressources et les collectivités avec la décentralisation peuvent accompagner ces initiatives. Nous pensons également que certains partenaires comme le FIDA, la FAO, le GEFAR même et d'autres partenaires peuvent s'impliquer dans cette activité de prospective locale pour nous accompagner, accompagner la société civile, accompagner notamment les organisations paysannes à s'approprier cette initiative. Mais nous pensons également que les forums régionaux de recherche peuvent également accompagner les organisations de producteurs et les projets de développement au niveau international. Donc, en fait, l'initiative prospective pour nous jadis une action d'experts externes devrait être une action appropriée par les organisations paysannes et nous souhaiterions que le GEFAR accompagne cette initiative avec l'ensemble des donateurs. Je vous remercie de votre aimable attention.
Welcome on stage, Jim Carno.
Hi, good morning. So, well, I mentioned this morning that, you know, young people have to be at the forefront, and that was 5 years. I mentioned probably 3 to 5 years, but we can do it now. And we can start by coming up with collective action. And so this is what we'll be talking about with Youth Planning Rural Futures. So can I have the next slide, please? Okay, just maybe you can just show everything. Thanks. So what we want to achieve is really have a critical mass of young professionals who are grounded in forward thinking process. So Robin mentioned already what the forward thinking process is, the using the future to change the present, to change the future. And we want to build a group of young professionals and even with other stakeholders where we can collectively come up with an action or a program or an activity that can be short-term and long-term that will build on foresight. So YPs, young professionals using foresight analysis to identify change and disruptions affecting the agricultural systems and how they can influence the future. So with the same model, how can we use foresight analysis to change these factors that affect the future? And young professionals using forward thinking and outputs to influence change at all levels of decision-making processes. So with that foresight, how can we effect change and how can we have young people strategically involved in the different levels of the decision-making processes? So those are the things that we want to achieve. Next slide, please. Okay, so what we have done so far basically is, if you could see the next, if you could see this illustration, we have a Foresight ambassador in YPARD who has been trained under Foresight with Robin, and this same person, Bunmi, is already, he has sat already in FARA, and he has also facilitated a participatory prospective analysis. And just last September, we also had a YPARD Asia Pacific Foresight training with country representatives from Asia Pacific of YPARD and several graduate students from the Chinese Academy of Agricultural Sciences. So the people who were involved, if you could see that what the young people have been doing with YPARD is that really we've worked together with GFAR, specifically the Global Foresight Hub, YPARD Global, YPARD Asia Pacific, and also FARA, as I have mentioned that Bunmi is in there. So the results basically from these actions can be seen in the next slide. Yeah, so we have young professionals equipped with the fundamentals of what foresight analysis is. And really using that forward thinking, the country representatives of YPARD Asia Pacific, there were six or seven of us, after the foresight training, we built on that foresight training, the scenario building and all that, to go into the strategic development plan that we've come up for YPARD Asia Pacific in the next 3 years. And we have a document on that, and even Robin was there when we were doing all this. So the YPARD representation also is also seen in FARA. They facilitated an Africa Foresight Academy, and this is where our YPARD Foresight Ambassador, Bunmi, sits and also contributes. Next, please. So that's Bunmi, and so these are examples of just Bunmi on the top left, facilitating the participatory perspective analysis. And the next two pictures is what happened in YPARD Asia Pacific. So if you can see, we're equipping young professionals and we want to build this and we want to bring this in a wider scale, in a bigger level. Next, please. So what we want to achieve through GCARD 3 while we're all here, different stakeholders, is that we want to get young professionals to recognize the value of foresight, and not only young professionals, but even include other stakeholders to work with the young professionals to come up with collective action using foresight. And this is where we come up with the next one, where we want to identify key activities on which we can mobilize young people around to have a collective action using the future to change the present, to change the future. And we want to come up with strategies on how to integrate youth forward thinking. Young people normally can see in their own perspective something in the future, but there's also a hindsight from the senior professionals. Like what I said this morning, that a while ago, is that the two generations have to work together. And if we want to effect change in different levels in the agricultural sector, that we need to work together with young people in forward thinking to initiate programs among different stakeholders. These are the agencies, yes, the research institutions, the NGOs, the CSOs, all of the people represented in this GCARD 3 process. And we want to link YPARD to existing collective actions on foresight to enhance young people's involvement. So whatever existing collective action your institution, your organization may have, we want to link YPARD in and have youth integrated into that collective action using foresight. The partners, we want to look at stakeholders who are, we're open to all, but we specifically want to target organizations with youth-focused programs. So if you may be a research institution, an NGO, a CSO, a farmer organization, etc., and you have youth-oriented programs, youth-oriented activities, we want to sit with you and really discuss what is the next steps, what are the next steps that we can do collectively. educational institutions, of course, the educational sector is also key to developing the mind of the young people and the young professionals. And this is where we also want to get the educational, the academe involved in using foresight analysis to see what are the next steps and what is the evolution of education probably in agriculture and how it can change and influence the future. And of course, people with willingness to support youth-based transformations. And it would help a lot if we get policymakers or people who's working with the governments and government agencies, because no matter what we do, there is still a big effect externally that policies affecting agriculture, policies promoting youth involvement can really help a lot with collective action. So thank you.
Stage, Mami Suma.
Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. Je vais devoir vous exposer ça en français. Donc, la prospective territoriale au service du développement rural, réaliser un travail de prospective et réalisé au Mali et à Madagascar sur les zones rurales. Alors, qu'est-ce qui nous a poussé à faire ce travail et pourquoi, qu'est-ce que nous voulons atteindre comme objectif? Bon, ça a été dit depuis ce matin. Donc, nous sommes en Afrique au sud du Sahara, dans ces deux pays, avec des défis importants au niveau démographique, économique et climatique, où les territoires ruraux changent énormément, les besoins en matière de développement évoluent et la séparation, la différenciation entre le monde rural et le monde urbain s'estompe. Et c'est dans ce contexte que nous avons voulu cet exercice pour améliorer la capacité stratégique des acteurs locaux. On en parlera plus tard, donc les responsables des collectivités, d'associations, et favoriser leur implication dans la vie publique pour répondre à ces défis de développement que je viens d'évoquer plus haut. Alors, qu'est-ce que nous avons fait? D'abord, les partenaires. Donc, ce travail a été réalisé avec des collègues du CIRAD, de l'Institut d'économie rurale du Mali, de l'IISS à Madagascar, avec l'appui financier de l'AFD et l'Université de Bamako. Donc, ce travail, nous l'avons réalisé en partenariat avec les responsables des collectivités locales dans les deux régions, j'aurais dû dire. Donc, à Madagascar, c'est une région rurale comme au Mali. La région de Ségou, à Madagascar, c'est la région du Vaguinankarach. Donc, avec les responsables des OP, les représentants des sociétés civiles, de la société civile, des organisations de jeunes, etc. Alors, à quoi consiste le travail? Donc, il y a eu au préalable tout un travail de partage, d'implication de ces différents acteurs que j'ai évoqués. Et donc, au niveau recherche, de façon classique, on a commencé par une recherche bibliographique pour reconstituer la trajectoire de la région de ces dernières années. Ensuite, à partir de cette trajectoire, on a interrogé aussi toute une série de personnes, ressources, de ménages, réalisé des projections démographiques pour arriver au diagnostic territorial où est-ce que la région en est aujourd'hui et après, avec ce groupe d'acteurs, se projeter dans l'avenir. Il est important de noter que ce travail donc, de projection a été réalisé principalement par ces acteurs locaux, comme madame vient de dire, pour le cas des OP. Alors, cette réalisation, qu'est-ce qu'elle a permis rapidement hein, en termes de résultats? D'abord, la démarche, elle a été éprouvée. Donc, une démarche de prospective réalisée au niveau local et avec des acteurs locaux. Ça, c'est le premier acquis. Mais cet acquis, il en découle donc l'alimentation du débat au niveau local, le développement local Les questions qui y sont liées ont été largement évoquées par les participants lors de ces ateliers-là, à partir de la trajectoire des régions et des projections sur 20 ans, donc 2035. Et ça a été aussi l'occasion de mettre en synergie un groupe d'acteurs locaux venant de différents horizons pour se mobiliser toujours dans le cadre des approches de ce genre, d'imaginer le futur de la région. Et en termes de perspective, tout ce qui peut avoir comme politique d'accompagnement des dynamiques locales, notamment la décentralisation qui est une des orientations fortes aujourd'hui de façon générale en Afrique. Donc tout cela, tous les produits issus donc, de ce travail, que ce soit en termes de diagnostic, d'atelier prospectif, de construction de scénarios, sont sur le site qui est indiqué en bas. Alors, pour cette conférence, qu'est-ce que nous proposons? En tout cas, nous attendons avec les différents partenaires que vous êtes ici autour de la table d'engager un dialogue pour ceux qui s'intéressent à des démarches de ce genre pour construire de nouveaux exercices en matière de prospective territoriale à l'échelle locale pour déterminer des futurs possibles pour quelques régions rurales. Donc ce travail commun peut amener à améliorer, à changer d'approche, à créer des réseaux entre des chercheurs qui sont dans la salle ici ou ailleurs, d'autres acteurs du développement, j'ai vu madame des organisations paysannes, ainsi de suite, et surtout aussi des représentants des collectivités locales s'ils sont ici dans la salle. Donc, in fine, voir s'il y a, j'en ai vu quelques-unes, des initiatives actuelles ou futures pour qu'on puisse travailler ensemble, répliquer la démarche et partager les expériences. Voilà, en résumé, c'est ça. Donc, les institutions de recherche, les OP, tous les acteurs du développement local et les institutions régionales ou sous-régionales dont l'appui est important non seulement pour répliquer dans différentes régions, aussi en termes de soutien financier. Merci.
Please welcome on stage Nelson Ogigi.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. By now, I think you must have identified a pattern to the presentations, which I shall also try to observe. But anyway, there is a number of principles that are emerging in the practice of foresight, and one of them is integration. So this morning, you heard from the CG that they are doing what is called site integration. But we have decided amongst ourselves as regional fora to come up with a kind of a global integration in the approach to which we'd like to develop foresight capacities in our respective fora. So you can see from the presentation that we have come together from the three regional fora, that is Arinena, Kakari, and Fara. And we've come up with a single presentation under this joint initiative, of course, with the particular advice from JIFA. And basically, I'll give you very briefly the objectives and then the achievements that we've had to date and the specific take-home message that you'd like from this particular meeting, and also the partnerships that we think will be able to help us in this process. So in regard to what we want to achieve, we are all agreed that we'd like to promote the emergence of foresight capacities in our respective regions. And basically, in this process, we would wish to take advantage of a collective approach whereby we would want to have cross-fertilization of ideas between the three regions, even as we move forward this process. But basically, we are targeting three key main areas. First of all is in regard to development of foresight competencies and capabilities at individual and organizational level. And of course, has been very eloquently elaborated by my young colleague there. We'd like to establish specific platforms to encourage the youth to engage in the foresight activities. And thirdly, we'd like to operationalize foresight activities in our various fora. And of course, this would be led by locally constituted teams. And then this is just an outline of an agreed process on how we'd like to carry out this. The first one is in regard to awareness creation, as well as promotion of foresight within our respective regions. And of course, the second one is designing a strategy for developing of foresight capacities, and then adoption of those strategies, advocating for support and funding of the strategies, and then initiation and facilitation of foresight studies. But the three regional fora have been engaged in this process at different times. FARA, of course, coming in first in 2012, has made some progress relative to the other two fora insofar as we've been able at least to embed specific actions in regard to foresight capacity development in our strategic outlook. And of course, APARI is coming in second. Now they are currently developing a strategy to develop foresight capacities in their region, and ARINENA is also initiating the process in this regard. Of course, we've received very able technical support from GIFA. Then what have we done so far? Way back in 2012, that is 4 years ago, there was a meeting that was held in Dublin whereby key experts in foresight met in order to help start the African chapter of the Global Foresight Academy. And in that meeting, a number of principles were elaborated, which have since been adopted, not only by FARA, but also by the other, you know, regional fora, i.e. KAKARI and ARINENA. And we have also tried to raise awareness in regard to foresight activities in our various fora. This includes FARA, KAKARI, as well as ARINENA. And in the case of FARA, we have even tried to, you know, symbolically launch the regional chapter of the Foresight Academy. And last year, we conducted an online discussion group and that discussion group was mainly facilitated by the WIPAD representative in FARA, and many young people were involved in that. Basically, it was to see how foresight can help to better improve agricultural development in Africa. There's a report to that effect, which you can avail even to other regional fora. And then we've also tried to mainstream foresight, as I've already indicated, in our strategic outlook. Right now, we have a dedicated unit that is handling the foresight initiative, and foresight is very, very properly embedded in the FARA strategic outlook. And of course, the other regional fora are also taking a cue from this, and they're right on track. KAKARI, for example, has already initiated plans to incorporate foresight in their midterm plan. And of course, ARINENA has so far developed a concept note with a view to including foresight in their strategy. We have also engaged, so far in Africa, for example, we have not institutionalized foresight, action per se. But the foresight activities that have been happening in Africa have been isolated, and of course, individual initiatives in this regard. But we have people who are already involved in this process. And even as we are trying to institutionalize the process at FARA, we are trying to make use of what is already happening on the continent. And in this regard, we've already negotiating partnerships with, for example, the regional agricultural foresight advisor, the foresight for development platform in Africa, and we're also trying to constitute a kind of a regional agricultural foresight advisory committee. And of course, the other regions are also following suit in this regard. Now, basically, all the three regional fora agree that we'd like to achieve one thing in this particular meeting, and that is to an inter-regional operational partnership for joint coordinated activities supporting the emergence of foresight in our regional jurisdictions. And finally, who could be our partners? Based on the principle of inclusivity, we would like to engage everybody on board in this process, but specifically all the three regional fora are involved. But in our own respective regional jurisdictions, we would be engaging regional-based foresight initiatives, like I've already said in Africa, Foresight for Development Platform, amongst others. The regional think tanks in agriculture and rural development, the National Agricultural Research and Education Centers, international research centers, as well as regional and global policy organizations. So basically, this is just a summary of what we agreed amongst ourselves in the three fora that we'd like to do. Thank you very much.
Please welcome on stage Charles N. Notham.
Good morning. I am not a specialist in agricultural research. I am a former politician from a rural region, and I am the chairman of a foundation for the dialogue between culture, South and North Mediterranean. The purpose of the foundation is to promote civilizational dialogue on a lot of topics, and this year it was a dialogue about rural development. Je dois pousser un bouton. Voilà. Merci. Et je continuerai en français. Donc, une fondation de dialogue civilisationnel entre le sud et le nord de la Méditerranée. Vous voyez bien les composantes culturelles différentes, importantes pour le monde entier, mais importantes autour de la Méditerranée. Dans une perspective à long terme, c'est prévoyé qu'il y aurait des difficultés et nous avons voulu parler sur le long terme, sur base de l'égalité dans la nourriture du dialogue et pas d'un dialogue inspiré d'Europe et imposé aux gens du Sud. Et le but, et si nous sommes dans la prospective, nous sommes proactifs pour une vision coordonnée, une vision partagée du futur. On fait un congrès rien que sur ça à Alger il y a 10 ans. On a découvert que sur le futur long terme, on avait dans le fond les mêmes buts, ce qui permet le dialogue sur des sujets plus particuliers. Je pousse le bouton. Oui, je vous montre une petite carte de la Méditerranée pour vous dire cette année-ci, donc l'année dernière, en 14 et en 15, nous avons fait 4 colloques régionaux au nord, au sud, à l'est, à l'ouest de la Méditerranée et un congrès à Milan au mois de octobre 2015 qui vient avec des résolutions courtes et la présence du commissaire européen à la politique méditerranéenne, à qui on a donné nos conclusions et qui nous a donné une réponse. C'était déjà le dialogue entre la société civile composite régionale et une autorité internationale qui a les moyens d'agir comme l'Union européenne. What we have done so far, on a démontré qu'on pouvait parler ensemble, Nous avons démontré que nous pouvions parler ensemble de manière intéressante et sur un pied d'égalité et sur le long terme. Deuxièmement, on a obtenu de l'Union européenne qu'elle mette dans sa politique de la Méditerranée les régions rurales à l'agenda, avec une position importante. Nous avons voulu aussi montrer que, enfin, pas seulement la politique agricole, mais la politique rurale dans son ensemble, c'est les régions ensemble qui doivent se mobiliser, peut-être par l'impulsion du monde agricole ou avec le monde agricole, mais qu'il y a besoin d'un partnership au-delà du simple secteur. On a souligné le rôle de l'importance du self-gouvernement, de la décentralisation, que pour mobiliser des communautés rurales, il ne faut pas les faire à l'échelle interrégionale, mais chaque région, on vient de le dire dans d'autres présentations, doit pouvoir se mobiliser au départ du monde agricole et avec les autres mondes de cette région-là pour faire une politique cohérente pour l'avenir. Et donc il y a aussi ce qu'on a réalisé, c'est qu'on a dit que l'on pouvait le mieux parler de la Méditerranée avec les parties de la Méditerranée qui ne sont pas en guerre. C'est un peu inutile de parler de développement régional concret quand il y a la guerre ou le conflit ou des drames. Nous commençons avec les partenaires du sud de la Méditerranée avec lesquels nous avons eu de bons rapports. What we want to achieve through GKR3. Nous sommes une région du monde, la Méditerranée. Nous voulons nous intégrer dans ce qu'on fait le monde entier. Nos idées parlent peut-être pour le monde entier et les idées du monde entier pour nous. Je l'ai constaté dans toutes les autres présentations. De montrer que dans la politique globale, il faut avoir une vision du développement rural. En même temps qu'il y a une vision du développement urbain, il y a beaucoup plus de théories du développement urbain et du planning urbain qu'il y a sur le planning territorial des régions plus défavorisées. De replacer le futur de chaque région dans l'environnement global, parce que ce n'est pas la même chose aux Philippines et en Afrique du Nord, ni en Afrique du Sud, et qu'il faut penser l'environnement global à travers la diversité, parce que souvent les slogans écologiques veulent dire les mêmes choses ici et là. Ce n'est pas la même chose ici et là. On ne doit pas faire un développement écologique le même dans les régions industrialisées d'Europe et dans les régions désertiques du Sahara. Il faut différencier, avoir toujours la même idée, l'égalité et voilà, l'égalité de traitement. Qu'est-ce que nous souhaitons avoir comme partenaire? Eh bien, bien entendu, les grandes organisations agricoles et de producteurs et de recherche. Pardon. Nous cherchons ici le contact avec les organisations agricoles et les chercheurs. Nous voulons trouver des facilitateurs locaux de développement pour faire des actions publiques. Il faut les trouver, nous pouvons les aider et nous désirons être en communication. Nous devons chercher des gouvernements qui veulent être vraiment des partenaires dans le développement régional, sinon nous devons prêcher qu'il faut un développement régional équilibré, mais c'est encore mieux s'il y a un gouvernement qui est déjà convaincu qu'il doit le faire, ou des organisations internationales qui ont les moyens et qui sont convaincues qu'elles doivent le faire. Et il ne faut pas négliger les investisseurs privés. Il faut que le monde privé, les investisseurs, le monde commercial jouent dans la partie. Et quand on définit les politiques d'avenir et quand il s'agit de les mettre en œuvre. Voilà, j'ai ici une petite brochure que j'ai faite avec les conclusions de notre congrès en quatre pages et la réponse qu'a donnée immédiatement le commissaire européen à la politique méditerranéenne que nous avions invité à venir nous écouter. C'est un exemple d'organisation du contact société civile et gouvernement quand il y a quelque chose à répondre des uns aux autres. Merci.
Please welcome on stage Jojo Badu Forsen.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'll be speaking to you about balancing specialization and diversification to sustainably transform rural livelihoods. What we really want to achieve through this presentation and subsequent discussions will be to find ways in which we can influence policies, flagship programs of the CGIAR, and large investments by farmers and other private investors so that they can balance issues of specialization and diversification in the production landscapes. And I'll come to the reason why. Apart from the fact that we need to contribute to the Sustainable Development Goals and the Aichi targets for making sure that we conserve and sustainably use biodiversity resources, there are very compelling issues that require us to make sure we take the benefits of both specialization and diversification when they occur. And some of these issues were brought up yesterday by Lindwe Sibanda, talking about the challenges of climate change and the challenge of malnutrition. These are key issues that we'll be thinking about in subsequent discussions, how to go about doing that. Now, the original diversification versus specialization debate has been that, well, specialization allows you to increase productivity and increase incomes. But the downside of this is that it exposes you to risk if things don't work out. We had a big example in Kenya about two, three years ago where the maize lethal necrosis occurred on maize farms and devastated the maize farms, which is the highest yielding materials which were on most of the commercial farms were completely devastated. And then I had policy discussions with the Secretary to Agriculture, who now recognized, he being a breeder, recognized that now there is the need to think a little bit more about this specialization issue and that we need to bring in some balance between specialization and diversification to avoid such disastrous consequences on the farmers. Apart from that, the reason why we want to look at this discussion is that there is a continuum when you go to the production landscape of farmers from high economies of scale to low, of high to low levels of market integration, of high to low levels of external input use, of high to low levels of tolerance to risk, and high to low levels of nutritional capacity to provide their nutritional requirements. And therefore, there is the need for us to continually look at what are the trade-offs, and if there are particular ways in which we can benefit from both ends, that is specialization when they occur and diversification when the need arises, we need to take this into consideration. Now, let me give you examples of some of the things we have achieved so far, because I understand I have only 7 minutes and I wanted to spend 20 minutes. Now, one of the things, I'll be speaking about two particular examples. And one has to do with our engagement with the government of Ethiopia on policy dialogue in relation to the school feeding programs. In many, many African countries, school children are being provided food because they may not be eating well at home. And we want to be sure that they eat well and, you know, have the aptitude to study. And this is an initiative that requires that the government works through the ministries, the various ministries of education, health, and agriculture, with the farmers and with the scientific research community. And this is the dialogue that we have had in Ethiopia. The second pilot program, which we worked on in Kenya, in Busia County, working with the Kenya Agriculture and Livestock Research Organization, which was the lead research institution that led that initiative, and worked with the support of Biodiversity International from the CGIAR, is to engage the government of the county government of Busia, because this was a pilot initiative, in the planning of agriculture and making sure that we can mainstream biodiversity resources that they have within the communities in the agriculture production to provide for adequate nutrition, adequate diversity in the food that is available so that people can have adequate nutrition. And this led to the joint planning, and this joint planning is embedded in the county agricultural program and funded through the Ministry of Agriculture. So that's the kind of thing that we would like, those kind of pilot initiatives are things that we would like to discuss with others who have similar initiative to see how do we bring different partners together to plan together to get them to be funded within the national institutions and then provide for good nutrition from the production landscapes. Now, I'll skip some of the things that I had wanted to talk about in 20 minutes and talk about what we want to achieve through the collective action. So through the collective action, what we want to do is that we want to look at, like I said, models of where we want to identify opportunities and threats to balancing the diversification and specialization, particularly where different people have different experiences that we can share together to see what is the way forward to involve all the different stakeholders that are involved at the farm level and at the district and national level in the planning of agriculture to provide for good nutrition, that is a nutritionally sensitive agricultural landscape, and then also to provide us the opportunity to deal with the emerging challenges of climate change, which requires that we have a diversity that's available to the farmers and they can choose which material to use at what time to produce. So we will look at the future scenarios and see what are the policies that we need to look at in this regard. Now, who do we want to work with? Like I said, the two examples that we have worked on clearly showed us the need for us to work governments from the various ministries, the researchers, that is, for example, the National Research Institutions, the CGIAR research institutions, from various disciplines. And then the farmers themselves, through their associations, the consumers, their representatives, and then also some program managers and NGOs who are working in the field. And then extension workers. With this, I think I want to thank you for this opportunity to make this presentation, but we have a lot more to discuss when we meet. Thank you very much.
Well, I think this was great. Thank you to everyone. Our catalysts, they are fantastic, really. I mean, if we have the same spirit for the coming 2 days, I'm sure we'll achieve a lot. They're very punctual, very precise, very to the point, and really, I didn't need to use my turmeric or actually they're on the table, or chili bags. I'm keeping them for further culinary uses, but I didn't have to use them at all, so that's really, really fantastic. Before we go to lunch, I'd like to again reiterate what we said about we are coming back after lunch to this same room, and what we will do is to discuss and ask questions and discuss further the six collective actions that our catalysts have presented to us, and we will see which ones we will want to go further with depending on your interest as a matter of fact, or if you have suggestions for collective action that you think do not fit in any of what has been presented, you will be again presenting them to us in the coming session. And we will prioritize, we will see how we will move on and which catalyst we will be taking, whose initiative we'll be taking further through the round tables that we have for the coming 2 days, as a matter of fact.